Welcome back, ladies and gentlemen. This is Just the Worst Movie Review Podcast, episode number 8, to be perfectly exact. And I'm your host, as usual, Billy Donnelly, who you can find at thisisinfamousjoeblow.com, and of course, right here at Just the Worst Podcast. And as we like to do week in and week out for this particular show, well, it's in the name, like to review movies. And every single week, we bring in a new voice, a new critic, a new perspective to comment and review the new films, the big releases that are hitting the theaters this coming weekend. And this week, no surprise, we brought in another esteemed voice, because why would I do anything less? So joining us this week on the show, you can find his writings in The Village Voice, Esquire, The Daily Beast, Variety, among others. Nick Shager joining us here on the show this week. So, Nick, thank you very much, man. I know you've been going through some heavy-duty life crisis right now. So to push that aside for just a little bit to come on the show, I greatly appreciate it.
No, thank you for having me. And now it's nice to have some talk about film rather than about life-related headaches, which have been numerous this morning with my house and whatnot, but everything's good. And luckily we have a number of movies to talk about that people are, I'm sure, very interested in hearing about and going to see.
And by life crisis, I don't mean anything truly horrible, just to put it in perspective before people were like, oh my God, what happened?
That's right.
It's home improvement stuff. But if you own a home, you understand, like, when that shit hits the fan, it's really awful.
That's right. No, it's just leaks. Leaks in the roof, leaks in the basement. Nothing that can't be fixed with some annoying time and some
spackle.
Money too. Yeah, and some spackle. Yeah, I'm hoping people show up again with some sealants. So
as we always lay it out right in the beginning of the show, people always say, well, why do you call the show Just the Worst Movie Review Podcast? Isn't that kind of awful? It is in a way, but we're self-deprecating. Everybody always likes to claim that they are the best, the most awesome, the most ultimate podcast that exists. I don't want to enter into that fight. So we'll just set the bar low. We'll call ourselves Just the Worst. And we'll go from there. No one wants to fight for that title. So in the interest of sarcasm, I'll take it. So that's what it is. But we don't just pull anybody off the street. We're not just pulling just the worst people off the street. We're pulling the best to be on Just the Worst. Ah, the irony. So so even when we book our critics to come on, they're like, what's the name of the podcast? Why would you put me on that show? But once again, that's kind of the way it's laid out. So before we get started, Nick, lay out your credentials so everybody knows that you are legit. You're not just somebody, once again, who's just somebody we pulled off the street. You are an authentic critic who's been at this for a while.
I'm as authentic, I guess, as I guess I get that title. I've been at it. I've been doing this for years now, 15 years or so, maybe a little bit less than that. As you said, I write for a lot of places right now. A lot of review work for The Village Voice, Variety, The Daily Beast, Esquire, a number of other places too, The AV Club, Film Journal International. I contribute sometimes to Rolling Stone and New York Magazine, and the Playlist over at IndieWire. My plate is full these days with criticism work and movie writing work, and that's what I do for better, and I'm sure some people think for worse, but that's okay. Multiple opinions are welcome.
And that's exactly why we have this show, is to not just have me talking every week and letting you know what I think. We like to bring in other people and a rotating crop of critics so that you kind of get a wide taste of what lots of people think of lots of different films. So we have three films on the docket this week, three fairly sizable films, I would say. The Hunger Games Mockingjay Part 2, The Night Before, and Secret in Their Eyes. So we're going to kick things off with, of course, the biggest one of them. That would be the finale of the Hunger Games series, franchise, brand, whatever it is that you want to call it. The Hunger Games Mockingjay Part 2. This is the second half of the finale following that time-honored tradition of taking your final chapter and now splitting it into two films in order to maximize your box office. And this is the story that concludes the journey of Katniss Everdeen leading a rebellion against the Capitol, trying to create a united Pan Am and liberate the people from the oppressive government that is led by President Snow. Jennifer Lawrence, of course, stars as Katniss Everdeen, and then you run down the list of the ensemble with Josh Hutcherson, Liam Hemsworth, Woody Harrelson, Elizabeth Banks, Julianne Moore, the late Philip Seymour Hoffman. We can go on and on and on. And Francis Lawrence directing the finale this time from Susan Collins' novel series. So let's just get right into it, get our hands dirty. The Hunger Games Mockingjay Part 2. Nick, what did this film do for you, if anything at all?
It didn't do that much for me. In full disclosure, I guess, the series as a whole hasn't done that much for me. And I thought that this final installment, in the same way that the Harry Potter films sort of worked in terms of splitting up the final book for two films, here the part two is clearly an improvement, I thought, over part one. And I think that's sort of an inevitable situation, given that part one is the prologue to part two, and the most exciting stuff is left for the second half. So in that regard, I think that it's a superior film, just narratively speaking, to part one. Unfortunately, I still think there's a lot of inaction throughout the film. I think a lot of, for a film that should be the more exciting climactic part, there's still a lot of just talking about the same things, and very little in the way of excitement, very little in the way of exciting dramatic confrontations. And I think that ultimately I found that the film didn't seem as interested in the sort of moral questions or the sort of deeper questions that it was pretending to be about, and wound up just sort of resolving itself on a pretty familiar sort of, you know, twist that had sort of obvious things to say about war and rulers and rebellion and whatnot. And so I just found it sort of lifeless. Also, I guess I would say that I think that one of the big problems with the film, and I think one of the big problems with the series in general, is that unlike almost every other really popular and or really great fantasy sci-fi, you know, works, especially epics, is that it is the, of all of them, it may be the least interesting in terms of how it's directed and how it looks. I just think the films are really visually dull, and I think that it has been hurt. I mean, I think Francis Lawrence is a perfectly fine director, but I don't think he brings any sort of style, any sort of touch to it that would elevate it. I mean, this is a far cry from, you know, Peter Jackson's artistry. It's a far cry from even David Yates's work on the final Harry Potter films. It's a far cry from, you know, the Star Wars films. I think we can knock, you know, even the prequels a lot, but they are visually much more interesting than the Hunger Games. It's just, I think, a very dull, drab thing. And I know that's what they're going for, but I think it winds up diminishing the sort of epic feel and epic scope and epic import that they're striving for. So And I, as I wrote in my review for the playlist this week, I thought that was particularly disappointing because the film is to some extent about images and how images or how wars are fought through images and through imagery. And I thought that it was a funny thing for the film to be about, given that this film doesn't really care that much about telling its story visually. I think it and that is a missed opportunity, let's say.
Yeah, so, it's definitely, you know, hitting the high points of the novels.
Sure.
You know, and as a result, it's very by the book in that way of like, we have to get these moments rather than we have to transform these moments into something on screen. And, you know, I mean, the Peter Jackson and the Potter stuff, I mean, they kind of have a different feel to them because they're able to deal a little bit more fantastical. You know, they have these kind of entities involved, whether it's wizards or magicians or whatnot, that I think give it kind of this fanciful thing because we're dealing with this dystopian thing. I think that's part of what works against that. But that doesn't mean it doesn't have to not be visually interesting. I mean, you could, you know, just earlier this year, you look at something like Mad Max Fury Road, which is existing in this dystopian wasteland.
There you go.
You know,
yeah, that's
far worse than what you're dealing with in the Hunger Games, and it's beautiful to look at. So
right.
So it doesn't have to be a restriction or something that works against your story. There are ways to tell it that make it visually interesting. I would agree with you that they are kind of bland. I think for me, the Hunger Games series is very uneven. Going back and having watched the first film, is very ugly. It's very the way it's shot, lots of close-ups, lots of handheld, lots of shaky cam kind of stuff. And you could tell they were trying to hide the seams. They didn't have a lot of money for that film and a decent budget, but they were trying to hide the fact that they didn't have it. So as a result, you know, they're covering up those edges and trying to get you focused on certain things. But if you look at it as, you know, if you look at it as a fan, you don't notice those things. If you're looking at it as a film, you say, wow, this is kind of hideous looking. I think Catching Fire is the best of them.
I agree.
I think that was Lionsgate taking Hunger Games money and putting it back into the Hunger Games. And as a result, you kind of have this larger scale film. You get to kind of see what Pan Am is like, what the Capitol is like, what is outside of the arena. And that's kind of where some of the world building comes in. And as a result, it is larger than life. You are, you know, seeing all these locations. And that kind of goes back into, you know, almost like that Star Wars comparison where, you know, you look at Empire Strikes Back and even towards Return of the Jedi and in the original trilogy and even into the prequels, you're going places. You're seeing what this universe is like, and it gives you a taste of kind of the larger scale of it. For me, I'm a little bit higher on Mockingjay Part 2. I think partially it is because it's not Mockingjay Part 1, which is, you know, like just 2 hours of setup. Like it's just 2 hours of setup for Part 2. And I hate when they do these split films or these shared universes where they just take a film and they spin the wheels for 2 hours in order to set something up later. It's very TV in the way that, like, well, we have all of these episodes, but we can't fill it all with compelling story. So we'll just take this episode here and we'll kind of just jog on the treadmill for a little bit until we can move on towards kind of the climax. So Mockingjay Part 1 for me was just set up, just like, well, you know, Part 2 is coming. So it, you know, it sucks all this drama out of it. It's just kind of going through the motions and layering things and saying like, well, this is what you're going to need to know for later. This is what you're going to need to know for later. Almost like sitting in a review for a test. As far as like, these are what you're going to need to know for the final exam. And then with Mockingjay Part 2, I think there's interesting ideas. I think that's kind of where I I kind of took from it, because it's not so much this climax of just good versus evil, where then everything ends on a positive note. You know, evil has been defeated and the good rise up and now everybody lives happily ever after. I think especially kind of dealing with real world ramifications that we're dealing with now, there's a lot to say about kind of regime change and the aftermath of war and what is really at stake when these conflicts come about. And in that, I looked at it and I was like, this is actually kind of heavy for a young adult series. You know, not spelling it out, but giving some food for thought in those respects. And, you know, along the way, there's a couple of interesting sequences, but I do think that there is a lot of nothing going on. There's a lot of, you know, I think it's just, you know, it goes back to the novels and the structure. I think watching people walk around and create propaganda videos is not all that interesting.
No, there's way too much of that. But the first movie is just about her making commercials.
Yeah. and not Part being one, in the I fight mean, you know. Like that's kind of what you want to see. You want to see Katniss in the fight. You want to see kind of the rebellion and this revolution and people taking the fight to the Capitol and fighting for their independence, fighting against that oppression. And instead what we get is, well, this is how the marketing of that works. This is how we put a face on it and encourage those people, inspire those people to do it, but you never really get to see much of the fight. And I think that's kind of a misstep, just as far as storytelling, is that then it takes away some of the investment for when those moments do happen, because it's just kind of boom, high spot, as opposed to like, this is kind of just the way it is.
Yeah, and I agree with you that it does start to touch on some interesting things about the trauma of war, and as you said, about regime change and about how revolutions sort of work and then how they develop, especially as they're more successful. I wish that it had dug into those things more, especially given that, as we both seem to agree, not that much happens. There's like half of part two even is a lot of setting things up. It's a lot of further walking around or talking in bunkers, or, you know, and you feel like there the films could have been, part one and part two could have been merged. I think people would have preferred even a 2.5, 2-hour, 45-minute single film that dispensed with the repetition of some of that and got at these issues more. And I think that the other problem with these issues is I think they're just sort of undercut by the finale. And if we're going to sort of have a spoiler warning, I guess now would be the time, maybe. because I think that the climactic showdown, which is well handled, winds up sort of turning on a point about revolutions and about what happens when people gain power, even the supposedly good guys, that is, on the one hand, totally true. I'm not disputing it's sort of the intellectual point they're making. But it winds up being, at least to me, sort of a very obvious point. And they wind up resolving it in a way that I think undercuts the film, because the movie does sort of end on a happy ending. They try not to have it be happy. They try, and even in the final moments, show her still struggling with the aftermath. But that seems sort of tacked on, because really we get like a sort of Lord of the Rings sitting in a happy field while democracy has won. Her decision leads to real democracy and the good person taking over and putting in those elections. And so it addresses these issues, but then like she triumphs over them. She fixes it. And I get it. I understand. She's the heroine. This is a fantasy fantasy franchise. I'm not saying that this whole thing should end in some horribly bleak way. or that, you know, the hero shouldn't win, or that somehow that's a bad thing. It's not that, but it winds up saying that, yes, there are these issues with rebellions and whatnot, but luckily in this instance, you don't have to worry about those issues because she'll make the right decision and it will all work out. I mean, how does she not get punished for that final act? They just like sweep her out of the, they sweep her out of the public square. And then it's like, yeah, don't worry about it. You're good.
Yeah, then that's it. I think, to my knowledge, I believe the book gives a little bit more explanation as far as how that kind of resolves itself. And, you know, and then it's interesting that you bring up The Lord of the Rings towards the end, because I found that it had a similar problem that Return of the King did as far as ending, is that it doesn't really know where to end. The thing,
right.
The movie ends like five times, where you're just like, oh, okay, like it's winding down. This is it. And then another end happens and you're like, Jesus, man, this thing should have ended like 20 minutes ago.
Well, that's the thing. I had an editor of mine who I was talking with online after the film actually suggested that, you know, he had almost wanted the film to end before she shoots her arrow. And to leave it ambiguous. Now, as I said, I don't think that the dictates of such a franchise, given how it's constructed, can leave you hanging in midair there about her heroism or lack of heroism or whatever moral courage or moral decision. But I understand that desire on his part, because it winds up posing these thorny questions, but then at the final moment, it like really hastily resolves them all in like a pretty neat package. Mm-hmm. And then says, oh yeah, but she's sort of traumatized. Yeah. Okay. I mean, I guess she's traumatized, but she still has that sort of same inexpressive look on her face with like two happy kids in a like glowing field.
And it's a very bizarre sequence.
With the guy who also, and that's the other thing, you know, when it comes to this issue about the trauma of war and the scars and the, you know, the loss and all this stuff, it really does gloss those over. And the big place, even more than her, is with PETA, which I just, that was one of the things that really rubbed me the wrong way in part two. I already thought in part one that his brainwashing, which we don't see, we're just told, well, he's been given some magic drug and now it makes him angry at Katniss. Okay. And then he acts really furious and he thrashes around a lot and says lots of nasty things to her. And then in the second part, he just sort of magically gets better as he goes along. It just sort of wears off as he's exposed to her goodness. And it felt very easy. Like it was a predestined thing that he was going to snap out of it. You know, he initially acts poorly, but then they go to the next spot on their tour of the Capitol, and then he's a little bit better. And they go to a next spot and he's a little bit better. And then she kisses him. And then it's, you know, although it didn't make my review because I think it was deemed too spoilerish, it felt like, oh, well, maybe they're doing something with Sleeping Beauty, right? She kisses him and he awakens or something like that. But it just felt very, yeah, he's scarred until he's not, because Jennifer Lawrence is great. And
yeah, it's definitely a missed opportunity to do something, you know, dealing with like PTSD and whatnot and
right.
How that affects people who are engaged in battles like this. And once again, you know, dealing with the consequences of these situations and how they affect the people on the ground, how they affect the people involved. You know, it's different to talk about the politics of it and how it affects you know, society or countries, but when you get down to how does it affect the individuals, I think that's kind of this missed opportunity to kind of really say something about it and have this kind of a lasting effect that he's dealing with and she's dealing with as they try to move forward and have a family or move forward and have some type of future. I think the other part of dealing with that is that, you know, there's as far as the ending for me was concerned, I didn't have necessarily a problem with the way it was kind of resolved in trying to tie it up very neatly. For me, my bigger issue was that her decision seems very telegraphed early. Mm-hmm. From early on. They kind of lay out these ideas of like, don't trust anyone, watch out for these people, who's the real, and they telegraph these ideas right. So that, you know, I think when she makes that decision, when she ultimately makes a decision with the arrow, as far as like, who is she going to execute in this moment, it should come as a little bit more of a surprise that she doesn't make the choice that the series is kind of led up to. You know, the series yes. has been built upon, to this point, three films of a showdown. Three films that are supposed to build up to an interaction, a showdown between Katniss Everdeen and President Snow. Like, these are the two heads of state on both sides of the equation here that are supposed to come together and meet in a confrontation that will settle it all. And I think it's a ballsy choice to kind of opt out of that. I can understand where some people would feel gypped that they didn't get that. And that's why I think that's why I kind of like it trying to do something a little bit different, once again, tying into like regime change and things of that nature. But I just, leading up to that moment, I thought it was just telegraphed. Like, they were really obvious about where they were going to go with this thing. And I thought that was kind of just a missed opportunity, because the shock of that moment, you know, allowing people to enter in the headspace of why she would make that choice is a little bit more interesting than like, oh, well, yeah, that makes sense, I guess, because they've told me to this point. And also, to speak to the other thing, you know, dealing with the PETA stuff, I think what winds up happening, especially as we go later in these series that have gotten popular, that have their fandoms, is they get lazy along the way, because at this point you have Mockingjay Part 2. They assume that you've seen Mockingjay Part 1, Catching Fire, and The right. Hunger Games, and probably have read these books backwards and forwards numerous times. So as a result, they don't get into some of the minutiae or explain things as well as I think they could, because they assume that you already know it. But if you're just watching it, if you're a casual viewer, you're somebody that you're like, yeah, I like the Hunger Games movies, and you watch them because they entertain you for a few hours, and then you go on about your day. You don't really think too much about it. I think those people are somewhat lost. It leaves them behind a little bit, because not everybody is going to be hardcore into your series. And I think you have to take care of those people a little bit better than some of these films do, by just assuming everyone is a diehard fan.
Well, I think that's a problem that's true with this. It's true with a lot of what we now have as mainstream sort of blockbuster cinema. The world building multiverses that we have in various ways, and all these enormous franchises do increasingly, sort of like TV shows, demand a lot of knowledge of and familiarity with what's come before. And in a certain sense, that's great, because it allows for, theoretically, it allows for richer, you know, sort of long form storytelling. In another respect, it winds up feeling like, you know, you have to be a diehard to really get them. And, Mockingjay Part 2, I do think at that point, I mean, yes, it's not for people who haven't seen the other films. It's built upon them. I just wish that for a film series, it's, you know, we're talking about these sort of serious issues and all the things as if the movie were just a serious drama rather than also a rousing, you know, sort of teen-oriented adventure. And I don't want it to sound like I think those things are the only thing a movie like this has to do. It has to thrill you. It has to excite you, and has to engage you, even on a basic level. The reason I think we're talking about these deeper issues is that the films themselves sort of make those issues a priority, or they pretend to, or they want to make them a priority. And the film series wants to be about these things, about war, about rebellion, about personal moral and ethical issues that come into play when you're involved in such conflicts. And in that regard, the movie sort of wants to be serious, but it also wants to sort of be fantastical or be sort of more of a traditional fantasy. And it just gets a little stuck. It just gets a little stuck in between those things. And I think that fans will like part two. I mean, I do think they'll like it. Mm-hmm. But I think that the more casual fan, if you're not really invested in the films, I don't feel like they're rousing or, and I know they're not, that's sort of one of the more interesting things about them, that they're not really rousing. They're supposed to be grim and dark. And that's why I wanted it to be a little bit grimmer and darker. And as you said, as you said about the climactic twist, part of the big problem with that is that, yes, it's telegraphed early on that Katniss can't trust the people she's with any more than the people she's fighting against in terms of the leadership. It's so obvious that by the time that climax happens, we've already had the prior scene where Julianne Moore is suggesting other Hunger Games. I mean, you know, the idea that she's not a bad guy is not even in dispute. It's no one could be watching it and thinking that. And it's also a larger problem, I think, with all of these films that are built on these young adult fantasy franchises, which all, I wrote about this a year ago, are all predicated on very similar ideas. And one of the big ones is that adults can't be trusted. And that there are fantasies to some extent about kids rebelling against adults who are oppressive and tell them they can't be who they want to be and can't do what they want to do. And they need to conform to X, Y, or Z standards. And it's about kids rebelling against these people. That's certainly what Divergent is about. It's about what The Maze Runner is about. It's about what the Giver was about. And I'm forgetting another one, but there's another one in there. It's also, oh, the one that was with Harrison Ford and Asa Butterfield.
Ender's Game, yeah.
You know. Kids, you know, the adults can't be trusted, and the kids know better, and they've got to overthrow the adults one way or another. And so in that regard, because that dynamic is so apparent because they don't stray from it, one also knows watching The Hunger Games right away. Julianne Moore showed up on screen. The first time she showed up on screen, I was like, nope, she can't be trusted either. I mean, because she's a gray-haired grown-up, and I'm not kidding. You go back and look at those movies. All of the grown-ups that can't be trusted have white or gray hair. All of them. Just about all of them. They just can't be trusted. Meryl Streep can't be trusted. And so you wind up with a subgenre that neuters its own ability to surprise you because they all want to sort of provide the same fantasy for kid readers. And I get that. I get the kids want to... I mean, it's an obvious thing to play to for kids. I know you have young kids. I have young kids. My older daughter is not so slowly becoming a teenager. And I understand that fantasy. But if you're not going to subvert it, then you wind up being predictable.
Yeah, I mean, I don't have a problem necessarily with that because, you know, I remember my younger years and authority sucks. You know, sure. Like that's, I mean, that's what right? It comes down to is the authority sucks. Uh-huh. And it doesn't matter who it is, whether it's the boss, whether it's your parents, whether it's a teacher, authority sucks. Like, and that's what these, you know, that's the idea that these films are built on is authority sucks and question it and do your best to rebel against it. What it doesn't say is like, there's probably going to be repercussions to that behavior.
Right. And maybe you don't know best. And maybe just because you want to rebel against authority doesn't mean you know best or you have the best idea to replace those ideas. Like, you have to have your own ideas, right? If you're going to destroy one idea, you have to replace it with another.
Yeah.
I think that those are – it's those sorts of things. It's not that I object to, you know, stories about, you know, people rebelling against the elder powers that be. That's a, you know, age-old dynamic, and that's fine. But even something like Star Wars – where we have a son in battle with his father I mean, that is right, the Luke Darth Vader dynamic, and yet they complicate it. It doesn't just get resolved as like, in the end, the kid just gets rid of the dad, and that solves all the problems. We need a little something more. And
Well,
I
we
think
have three
these
more films coming to explore those ideas.
that's absolutely true, so I don't want to make a definitive statement. And I'm not trying to say that Star Wars is the most thematically complex film in the world. I just mean, even within the confines of those sorts of stories, you can tweak it a little more. I think that The Hunger Games, in the end, winds up saying that Snow is bad because the story has set him up to be just sort of patently evil, and oppressive against these people. And in the end, it just says the solution is, to get someone in there who will give us some free elections. And they do. So great. So it works. I mean, good. That tacked on character who came out of the blue. They interject into a couple of scenes ahead of time. So you're like, oh, that person, I guess, will factor in at the end because all of a sudden she's being thrust into our face. Out of the blue. Who was that? That was nobody. It's just some plot device. So I would have liked it better if we had, I don't know. I just think it could have been handled a little more deftly. But as I said, other people are going to like the film. It's certainly true to the books. My wife is telling me still, the movie's great. It's just like the book. And
And
so.
that's what it, that's all it amounts to. And the you talk about kind of the film doesn't feel that exciting. For me, what I found interesting there was that one of the more exciting and intense sequences that we get in this particular film is a direct ripoff of a sequence that is famous and iconic in Ridley Scott's Alien. I mean, it is. There's this scene in kind of the underground tunnels in the sewer,
Right.
where these pods are have been launched, and there's something that's coming to get them, but it's aped directly from the scene in the corridors in Alien on the ship, where,
Directly.
yeah, I mean, directly to the fact that they're shooting flamethrowers down in order to be able to see, it is directly aped from that. And look, I mean, I learned when I was in film school, steal from other people and make it your own. This is a stealing from other people and making it your own. And it's just amazing to me how that sequence could still works. And you could take it and you could drop it in another film, and it still is just as effective in that moment. It was just for people who may not have seen Alien before, who are watching this, I was like, those people should see Alien because they would really dig it because they're into this moment right now. And this is I mean, it's a rip off of that. Not that saying that that's a bad thing. I found it interesting that for me, the most exciting moment of the entire film is a moment that is stolen from another film.
It is the moment when the movie comes alive, so to speak. It's that suddenly it not just because Katniss is fighting, but because finally there's some real suspense and there's a real attention paid to suspense and action and building it. And I think that even though it's a total ripoff, it's a total ripoff. And they don't even really pretend it's not because of, as you said, the way they shoot it, the way it plays out.
The way the
It.
creatures look.
Yeah, the whole thing. That's right. The creatures almost have that look too. I agree in terms of the shape of their heads and the no eyes. It does, and yet you respond to it because I think in part because you're just at that even at that point, I was craving something to happen too. I just wanted something. Something where I was sort of, stimulated
Thrilled.
in an exciting way. Because I want some excitement. It does, whatever in whatever form you want to make, give it to me. So, yeah, it is interesting that is the best part, and it really is the only really thrilling sequence in both Mockingjays. which I think is, I think it says something about the either the book or it says something about the movies themselves. Even all the stuff with the pods before that, I found sort of nonsensical, and it wasn't very exciting. They kill off a few random people you don't care about who are there to be killed off. And at least at that moment, there was a real sustained attention to giving you some of the goods, and that's not an underrated thing.
No. So let this be a lesson to filmmakers out there. You want some excitement in your film. You want a thrilling moment filled with suspense and tension. Just go back to Alien and
That's right.
just steal from
Just steal from Ridley Scott.
just steal from early Ridley Scott, and you'll find a bankable moment. You'll find a moment that people are really into. All
That's
right.
right.
I think that's enough said on the Hunger Games: Mockingjay Part 2. I think there's some interesting ideas there. I do think film fans of the series will enjoy it. I do think it could have been better, but I think it's a kind of representative of the larger series, which is that you get some good, you get a lot okay,
Agreed.
and some slightly bad. And I think it's in that middle area. And I think you would agree there once again that it's, for the right audience, it will play perfectly for them.
It will.
For everyone else, maybe not so much.
Yeah.
All right, our next film is The Night Before, which is our first Christmas movie of the season, our first real, truly Christmas movie of the season, which is once again speaks volumes about our society that we get it in November. But The Night Before is directed by Jonathan Levine and stars Seth Rogen, Joseph Gordon-Levitt, and Anthony Mackie as in a buddy comedy of sorts, as three longtime friends who have developed into their own family unit of sorts, who are starting to grow up, starting to realize that life is more is there's more to life than just hanging out and smoking weed and getting drunk and having a good time. Responsibilities and adulting have to enter into the fray at some point in time, and this is their last night of celebrating a tradition of spending Christmas Eve together as sort of this family unit. And as a result, of course, mayhem and hijinks and shenanigans will happen, and some laughs, I think, along the way as well, giving you some raunch as well as a little bit of sweetness, a little bit of heart. So, Nick, The Night Before, how did this play for you?
Well, it actually played great for me. I admit that I think, like everyone, I'm a little tired of the man-child grows up subgenre that we've had a lot of over the last, let's say,
30
decade
years.
plus. Yeah, well, certainly 30 years, but I think especially in the last decade plus, between everything that Adam Sandler and Will Ferrell and Judd Apatow have done has really put at the forefront the idea that the idea of these of building comedies around absurd, immature knuckleheads who do a lot of really funny, fun-seeming stuff in the first half of the movie. And then in the second half of the movie, they learn that all that fun stuff really was, they need to grow out of that and become, responsible adults. And whether that means it winds up meaning a whole lot of different things. And I think that this movie doesn't really subvert that in a way that at least a few of the other films in that genre do. But I have to admit, for one, my first criteria with any comedy is, whether it made me laugh. And this did. I just found myself amused by it. I thought that the gags were funny. I thought that the rapport between the three guys was funny. I thought that Michael Shannon, who I'm sure we'll talk about in a supporting role, was really funny. And I thought that the movie was more successful. On top of that, I thought then the movie was more successful than a lot of other comedies like it, in that it was able to maintain some humor even during its last third, when usually comedies in general start to flag. And especially these sorts of comedies flag as they get a lot more sort of earnest about, you know, well, you really should, you know, settle down and, you know, have kids and all that stuff that we were just celebrating, we're now going to sort of shake our finger at a little bit. And that always rubs me the wrong way. Not because I don't agree that people should grow up, but I don't like comedies sort of giving me one thing and then telling me later that I shouldn't really want that. It's like, don't play me both ways. But here I thought it stayed funny. And I think also I like that Seth Rogen in particular, who has been the star of a lot of these sorts of films, is continuing to sort of at least have that sort of man-child who needs to grow up character. He sort of keeps addressing it at different older stages of life. And so we're down the road a bit from where Knocked Up was at this point. Where Knocked Up, he was just a single goof. And then by now, we're already a guy who's already married and a professional. And it's not that. Instead, he's struggling with sort of facing and confronting the responsibilities that are about to be land on his lap because he's going to be a father. And I like how it continues to sort of at least address that constant he seems to constantly be addressing that stress and that difficulty of facing increased responsibility, adult responsibility, at later stages. And maybe it's also because I'm of a similar age to him. It feels like his characters are at least progressing a bit in a way that I can relate to. But mostly I just thought it was funny.
Yeah, he has definitely evolved as we've gone. It's not like a Sandler syndrome where you just feel he's been playing the same character for like 20 years. And it's a guy who's never – like he never changes. He's just the same guy. Just in a different set, just in a different setting. Well, now he's playing golf, and now he's a rock star, and now he's there. Like you know, it's the same guy. Here, it's similar to kind of a character he played in Neighbors, which is this guy who is trying to grow up. He is trying to move on. But there's that struggle. There's the struggle of, yes, I am an adult. Yes, I have a wife, and I'm gonna have a kid, and I'm a professional. But there's still that part of me that looks and says, oh, God, I would love to just cut loose every once in a while and just fuck all that responsibility stuff. I just want to be able to go out and have a good time like I used to and not worry about the consequences or the repercussions or how I'm going to feel tomorrow. So I think, yeah, in that respect, like I really did like what Rogan did here, and he is he's become much more subtle over the years too. He used to be a little bit more showy as a younger actor, as a younger comedian. I think now it's a little bit more subtle, and as a result the gags pop much more when he's a part of them, because there is kind of this normalcy to him now. It used to be just kind of be like goofy fat guy, you know, like that was kind of the role that he filled. Now it's much more subtle, so that when these things do happen to him, there's a normalcy, you know, it's disrupting the normalcy that you now see in Seth Rogen. And that's what makes those movies so funny. I do think the underlying thing of the film is that, you know, that one of the underlying strengths of the film is these guys feel very organic. You know, they feel the chemistry between them feels real. It doesn't feel like somebody went like, well, who are the three stars that we can get and put together, and then you throw them on the screen and it's just painful to watch them interact with each other because you're like, they don't feel like friends. These guys feel like real friends, and as a result you like hanging out with them. Like that's you know, when you watch a film like this and you're sitting there for an hour and 40 minutes or whatnot, you want to be willing to spend time with them. You know, they can be complex, and they can, you know, they don't have to be relatable. It goes back to that idea that, like, not, you don't have to relate to every character, or not all characters have to be liked. But when you're watching a film like this, you should want to spend time with them, because beyond that, like, why would you want to sit and hang out in a friendly environment with three guys who you would not want to hang out with in real life? Like, in real life, if you look at them and you'd be like, nah, I'd rather do something else with my evening. Then you're not going to invest in what they're doing in a film like this. And I think as a result, you have three guys who are all going through their own things. Like, I think that's also one of the things that the film does well, is that it's not just one person has their quest, their mission, their story, whatever, and the other two are just like jackasses that are, you know, throwing up obstacles in the way, preventing them from getting that. These are three people who are all dealing with their own sort of adult things. Along the way, will try to help each other because they have that very close-knit, very tight-knit dynamic to them. But it is three people who are trying to figure out how they become adults, how they move beyond this thing, which has been great for like 14 years as a tradition. But even the traditions that we hold on to, as we get older and our life changes and, you know, we get maybe married or we move or we don't see our friends as much as we used to, accepting those changes and figuring out, how do we adapt? How do we create new traditions? How do we create something different for ourselves, something fresh for the future, as opposed to, no, we're going to do the same exact thing for the rest of our lives.
Right. And I think all of those things are successful in the film because they sort of mesh very easily with all the gags that they do. I agree with everything you're saying, and I think that one of the strengths is that all three characters are going through different things that are all of a piece in that they're all about facing truths about themselves and about being an adult and becoming an adult and accepting responsibilities for the choices you've made or the situations you're in. But they do that in a very natural way. And as you said, this is another Seth Rogen movie, a lot like the stuff in Knocked Out with Rogen and his friends, where it becomes a hangout movie. And it is predicated on the idea that you're going to want to hang out with these guys. If you're a moviegoer who doesn't like Seth Rogen and Joseph Gordon-Levitt, then it's definitely not for you, because this is a movie that's providing you with a fantasy, not just of, you know, going out with your friends and revisiting those sort of, you know, crazier things you wanted to do or dreamed of doing or always did, but wanting to sort of be a part of their posse. I mean, that's the fun of it. You get to be the fourth member, so to speak. And for me, I liked hanging out with them. I liked their different sort of the way they each had sort of a different tone to them, to themselves, and the way those played off each other, the sort of straight man stuff with Gordon-Levitt, the cocky showman stuff with Mackie, and the drugged lunacy of Rogan, which all sort of combines. And then they a lot of this comes down to, did they come up with funny things? Mm-hmm. And they do. I mean, the scene in the church is really funny. The stuff, all the stuff with Michael Shannon, as I said, who sort of functions as the means by which the movie gets sort of Christmas carol-y.
Yes.
But in a crazy, drugged way. And he's just great in it. He's just so weird. I mean, because the movie does such a smart thing with playing off his creepy intensity.
Yeah.
and sort of making it so that you don't know if he's being like scary, intimidating, or he's just being really stoned and weird. And whether he's like being nice or not. And it walks that really weird line, and it gives each of them some time with him too. So you're constantly seeing him bounce off of things. There are a lot of funny people in it. I mean, Mindy Kaling's good, and And then I also like that, as I said, the gags play into the themes we're talking about. So they're constantly doing stuff, right? They're doing this one last thing that they always used to do as kids. And so all of the stops along the way involve sort of throwback things. So they're performing the thing from Big. They're performing on the keyboard from Big, which is a nod to their childhood, you know, sort of shared childhood pop culture stuff. And they play GoldenEye on the N64. And they do Run DMC in the karaoke. And so all the gags are also sort of rooted in that desire to, you know, sort of go back a little bit. And the movie doesn't in the end wind up telling you that you can't do that. It just tells you, you know, that some things do get old. They just do. It doesn't mean they weren't great. It doesn't mean that you wouldn't like to do them again, but they also sort of get old. They get a little old. I mean, I can say for myself, I understand that. I still like going out and partying, but I wouldn't want to party like I, you know.
No, I just can't.
At a certain point, you've done it. At a certain point, everyone, I think, or most people feel like they did it.
Yeah.
And it's not a bad thing.
No, you just kind of get tired of it. And then you get to a point where you're like, you know what I would rather do? I would rather sit on my couch and watch Netflix and not have to do anything. And, you know, and I think that's also one of the thing is one of the elements of the thing of the film that work really well is that it plays upon that nostalgia that comes with Christmas, you know, that warm mm-hmm. feeling that you get of, you know, what Christmas has always felt like and what it always meant to you. And because it's a Christmas movie and, you know, Seth Rogen's in there and he's Jewish. So it's funny in that respect, this kind of outsider in there who's like, like there's a great gag with him going into a church and where he's never been and he doesn't understand what's going on other than like what he's seen on TV. You know, so even when he has like an interaction with crucified Jesus, he's taken aback. He's like, that who's that guy? What? That's so yeah. So like that's a funny gag. There's a really hilarious gag dealing with sexting that had me just rolling. And you bring up Michael Shannon who's a scene stealer here. You know, like every when it first happens, you know, and Michael Shannon's not somebody that everybody knows, but if you know Michael Shannon, you have an idea of kind of the characters that he plays, which are always very kind of strange, very kind of out there, off the radar kind of dudes that always bring something interesting to the table. And here, as the drug dealer that they all encounter trying to secure some weed for their evening, there's this very – there's madness around him. And when he sits down, with them, there are these moments of seriousness and these moments of thoughtfulness and these moments of truly bizarreness. And as you're watching it all unfold, you're laughing because you don't know what to fully make of all of this. Like you're just watching it happen. And it's truly weird. And I've been a Michael Shannon fan for a while. And after watching this, it just made me want to watch more stuff. I was like, Michael Shannon should be in just about everything. Comedies, drama, whatever, dance movies. I don't care. Put Michael Shannon in it. I'm going to check it out because something like this, where he's once again doing something different than he's done before and excelling at it, In a film that already has three incredibly funny guys at the forefront, I mean, that just kind of also speaks volumes about what he brings to the table when you put him in a movie.
Yeah, no, he's great. And I mean, I think he's great in general. And I just think that it shows that he should do more sort of unconventional things because he has a certain sort of very, as I said, intense and intimidating, and often he's scary. And he's certainly always a little off kilter. There's always something a little off about him one way or another. And here he uses that to his advantage because it helps nail punchlines and it helps create a sort of general uneasiness about the character. And he winds up being a more fantastical player here, which also works nicely. He's obviously a more outlandish or sort of fictional character than the three guys, who I think it works because they feel like real guys. And I think that's sort of what Rogan does that the other people I was describing, especially like Will Ferrell. Will Ferrell is much more absurdist, mm-hmm. in a clearly I'm playing an absurd character sort of way. And that's intentional. Rogan is very good about rooting it in a guy who seems like a guy. I don't know. I just saw Rogan on SportsCenter yesterday. He comes across similarly.
Yeah, he's just a guy.
Yeah, he seems like he seems like that guy. And so I think that works well. All three of them actually come across that way too, right? Mackie and Joseph Gordon-Levitt, they seem like people you could hang out with. So that works nicely against Shannon, who seems like someone from another planet and who here just you can't quite figure it out. I mean, you understand what he's doing, but you can't quite figure out. He's just so weird that he's hilarious.
Yeah, and I think to give credit on this film is Jonathan Levine as the director, who has done films like this before. I mean, not a Christmas film obviously like this, but you kind of go back over his filmography, whether you're dealing with 50-50 or these film or Warm Bodies, even, which are funny on a certain level, have humorous moments, but really give you characters that you can kind of invest in, characters that you enjoy watching while it deals with some other issues. So it's like a sheep in wolf's clothing. It's like, we're gonna give you a funny movie and it's gonna be hilarious and you're gonna laugh, but at the same time, if you actually give some thought to the movie, we're gonna have something to say with it. It's not just going to be wackiness all the time. There's gonna be those moments of hilarity, but we're gonna give you some heart. We're gonna give you something to think about, something to consider, so that this movie will stick with you. It's not just gonna be, it's not a throwaway movie. This is a movie that I could see myself, as the holidays come around, kind of gravitating towards, throwing it in the cycle of Christmas movies that you watch around the holidays, up there with like Die Hard and A Christmas Story, one of those movies that, and Bad Santa, as far as like my repertoire is concerned, but the films that make you feel kind of good around the holidays, give you a little bit something. I can easily see The Night Before becoming part of that group.
Yeah, I agree. I think it's just hefty enough to be more than just a throwaway. And then, as I said, my rule always with comedies, just like with horror too, I find those two genres, and if it scares you or if it makes you laugh, then that's a lot of the work.
Yeah.
I mean, I want to go to a comedy to laugh, and I don't think I had to forgive much in this case, because I think the movie has some extra heft, but you can always forgive some minor missteps if you're laughing.
Yeah, and I would absolutely agree.
I just think it's funny. I think people will think it's funny in a way that I think something like The Interview, which obviously was mired in controversy and all that stuff and the release schedule, but in the end, The Interview isn't as funny.
No.
That's the Interview's real problem compared to this. It all has to do in the end with how funny the jokes are, how funny the setups are, how funny the premise is, and then everything else that goes along with it. And here they wind up getting sort of everything, I think, right. So, people who like those guys and who like the holidays, it's pretty strong.
Yeah, comedy is always subjective. People laugh at different things. Different things make different people laugh and strike their funny bone and speak to their sense of humor. But there are certain comedies that come out that I think have widespread appeal and make lots of people laugh, as opposed to kind of just segments of people. And I think this is one of those films that gets lots of people to laugh, and that's also why I would highly recommend checking out The Night Before, even if you're not into the spirit of Christmas, you know, even if you're Kwanzaa or Festivus or whatever, I still think there's something there for you to really make you laugh. So, yeah. So the night before for the both of us, I think, are a good solid recommendation. That will bring us to our last film, Secret in Their Eyes, which is based on the 2005 novel by Argentinian author Eduardo Zachary. This is also an Americanized remake of a 2009 film, also known as The Secret in Their Eyes, which was directed by Juan José Campanella and won the Oscar for Best Foreign Language Film that year. So once again, this is the American studio system saying, oh, good foreign film, we will just take it and Americanize it and see how that works out for everyone. This one stars Chiwetel Ejiofor, Nicole Kidman, and Julia Roberts as three co-workers in the counterterrorism unit of the United States, working on terrorist activity during the 9/11, the period around 9/11. And a murder happens that kind of throws that dynamic into question, their colleagueship as well as their friendships, and kind of dealing on two different timelines between what happened in the past during the timeline of the murder happening and what is now happening 13 years later during this unsolved mystery where obsession kind of comes into the mix in trying to see if some type of resolution can be found for this case and to bring peace of mind to the individuals involved. So Secret in Their Eyes, Nick, what did this one do for you?
I guess I'll start by saying that I'll start with the positives because there aren't that many. I thought that the film's, you know, the film has an all-star cast. It stars Nicole Kidman and Julia Roberts. And I thought all three of the leads were as strong as could be given the material. And I think also that the writer and director, Billy Ray, whose stuff I have liked, and in fact, I still think that the film he directed a little over 10 years ago, Shattered Glass, about the plagiarism case with what was Glass's first name? Stephen Glass? I can't remember. Was very good. But he does his best here trying to shift his source material to a present day American context. The film and the novel take place in the 70s in Argentina. So it's a very sort of different political context. And so he's not just updating it. He's trying to reconfigure its political context. And I think he does give it his best shot, but I just think the movie just doesn't work. I don't think it works in all sorts of ways. But I think the main way was that I just thought it was really frequently preposterous. And it just, from a basic storytelling perspective, it was just a mess. I think that it's inert for a lot of its runtime. It's just draggy. And there's no momentum to it, and things needed to happen more quickly and in a more interesting way. I thought a lot of the dynamics between the characters were really sort of simple and familiar and uninteresting. But the main one was that the main character, played by Ejiofor, is the counterterrorism agent who he's partnered with Julia Roberts's character, and Julia Roberts is the premise of the film is that Julia Roberts's daughter is killed, and her body is found at a mosque or next to a mosque where they have been surveilling potential terrorism suspects, and he becomes obsessed with finding the killer of his partner's daughter. And then in the present day, he's still obsessed and still after this guy. But I liked how the film initially teased out a lot of this information. You don't quite know. It sort of drops you into the story and makes you sort of play catch up as the plot's going on. And initially that's interesting, but then when you start learning what's happening, you realize that the main character, Ray, is just an idiot. And he's behaved in such an absolutely self-sabotaging, totally moronic, reckless way that I immediately hated him. And I couldn't, that alone sort of drove me nuts. What I'm referring to specifically is that the reason that he's still investigating the case and still obsessed with it in the present is because, as can be rightfully assumed from the get-go without even being a spoiler, they didn't, for whatever reason, get the guy. But it turns out that they didn't get the guy because they knew who he was, and they just broke every rule trying to nail him. They immediately break all protocols, and they're doing things that a 10-year-old wouldn't do if they were a cop, much less an actual cop. I mean, breaking and entering and stealing evidence and harassing, they're punching out witnesses, and they're you just sort of went like, what? Like, this is all your fault. Like, this guy could have been put. I just drove me nuts. And so right off the bat, I couldn't buy it.
Yeah,
It
and
just
there's all
seemed like.
things that are like, it's interesting that you bring that up because there's all these things that are like, in order for them to just to get the guy, just to get a case, just to get a suspect in custody, that when you would, if you were to look at it in the long play, would make it extremely difficult for them to get a conviction, if that was the guy. If you were to take that guy and be able to put that guy on trial, you have evidence that was taken, once again, outside of protocol. That's probably inadmissible. You have a confession, that was beaten out of somebody. That's probably not gonna fly when the lawyers get involved. So you have, these extremely heightened ways of trying to for them to get the guy that when you look at it are like, these would work against you. This wouldn't help you. Like, wouldn't it, is, doesn't it almost then make it worse that if you got the guy and they got off because of your stupidity, doesn't that hurt this and make it worse in the long run?
And that happens right off the bat. It happens like immediately. He immediately starts to, every single thing he does is ruining his case. Right? He even uses like the terrorism databases for like a homicide case. And someone says, like, that's not legal. And he's just like, whatever. I'm gonna do it because I know it's him. And then he gets all upset when when his terrorism bosses,
I like stop doing it.
right, say stop doing it. And then it turns out on one of the twists that the suspect is actually a potential informant for the government, and he's going to give up a sleeper cell. So this dynamic comes up where the government would rather keep him as an informant, even if he might have committed this crime. Now that's sort of an interesting dynamic, but it gets ruined by the fact that Ejiofor's character just behaves so stupidly that like it's all hopeless. Like he's just blowing everything up because he's not going to be able to arrest this guy. He's going to ruin the terrorism case. He's getting himself nowhere. So I felt like the whole thing was just sort of aggravating on a basic logistical issue, like that FBI agents wouldn't be so stupid, even if they were passionately. In fact, if they were this passionate, I think they would be more concerned with making sure they were going to be able to nail the guy than, being able to say, aha, I figured it out, even though I have, in the process, ruined any chance of ever bringing him to justice. And so that drove me nuts.
Yeah,
And
I mean, and to that point, I think you get into some interesting dynamics of, emotion, dealing with emotion, letting your heart lead your head when your head knows better.
right.
And I agree. I think there are interesting elements, and what Bill Reid having to do with trying to transition it to kind of be involved with the war on terrorism and the sacrifices that are made for the greater good, if you want to call it that. You know, like, oh, we have the daughter of one of our agents has been murdered, but do we let that slide because it may prevent another terrorist attack in the wake of 9/11, where everyone is very, very afraid, very paranoid, very scared. And that fear is driving a lot of the decisions that are being made. So I think in that respect, yeah, there's an interesting dynamic there. I think when you're dealing with obsession and people not being able to let certain things go to the point that it ruins their lives, I think that is an interesting idea to kind of deal with when you're dealing with these characters and, you know, how the murder happens and, you know, whether or not they could have done more, whether or not their lack of action or their lack of action may have prevented this murder from even happening. Oh, well, you know, one of those coulda, woulda, shoulda things. What if survivor's remorse? There's all these ideas that are out there that could be explored and would make for a better film. But instead, it's much more about trying to put together the pieces of the puzzle, trying to solve this mystery for the audience, which once again, as you mentioned, kind of never gather steam. And I think partially it's because anytime things look like they might be climbing and building any type of momentum, it just cuts to the other timeline and just immediately cuts off any progress that it's making during that time. It's like, if they would have let that timeline go on a little bit more and then cut, maybe you would have done it. Except the cuts are done premature to try and leave you hanging, leave you teased. That you, once they move, you feel you didn't get your money's worth in that respect. And then by the time they cut back, you just forgot. Like you're not in the moment anymore. You're like, we're in that part. All right, I understand. I remember now. But you're not in it anymore, and I think it's just a poor way to kind of tell the story and edit it together and make it work that I think does a disservice to the film by not getting you invested in those ideas and not getting you invested in those moments.
Yeah, I think a lot of that is true. I think that there are a lot of really interesting ideas here. There are almost maybe too many interesting ideas. They don't quite pick one to deal with. And they don't quite know how to synthesize them into a sort of coherent, you know, thread. And then the intercutting is ungainly. It's sort of clumsily put together, and it winds up being, as a result, there's no tension, there's no suspense, and then the climactic twist, which I won't give away, but is something that definitely tries to speak to at least one of the ideas in the film, which is about obsession and about the price of what they keep talking about as passion, what the price that is and how what justice really is and how justice affects you or vengeance affects you and all these things. But it all sort of hinges on this twist that I just found ridiculous anyway.
It doesn't feel earned. You know,
it doesn't, not
at all. And when those things happen, they feel like twists for twist's sake, or to throw something different at you to kind of throw you a curveball. It just it comes out of left field. It comes out of nowhere, and you're like, I don't. How did we get here? I don't understand how we got here. And you know, and you bring up, you know, all these different things that are kind of thrown in the film. You have like this unrealized romance angle that's kind of there that kind of just sits there.
And it goes on and on.
Too. Yeah. And with no real progress, it's just,
and no point.
Like you have these people that are obsessed with this thing and yet then they have time to take these moments to have something, some kind of awkward romantic interaction. It's very bizarre. And, you know, and I think G4 brings a little something to it at times when you're dealing with the obsession. There are kind of these subtle moments where you see what it's doing to him. He's racking his brain. He can't wrap his head around it. He's just exhausted by some of this. And I think those are some of the better moments. I think there is something more to do with that character if the film would let him. But then you look at like Julia Roberts, where they just are like, well, let's just frump her down. Like, we'll just frump her down and it'll be fine. You know, and that'll convey everything. And, you know, you're used to having, I mean, it's a Julia Roberts character that we don't really get a lot of. You know, usually we get either a sweetheart or somebody who's brimming with confidence. And here there is signs of that character early on. And then when kind of this tragedy takes over her life, that's all they do. Like it's kind of a lazy device to do anything with her, you know, and she'll get a speech here or a speech there, but they're just like, we'll just frump her down. You know, we'll put no makeup on her. Her hair will look a mess. She'll just wear mom's sweaters. Like she just doesn't give a shit anymore. And that will tell everybody everything they need to know. And it's kind of a waste of what she can bring to the table. And, I just found myself distracted by a lot of that because it didn't feel like there was anything there other than like how they made her look.
I agree. I think she's not, you know, the problem with that entire performance, and I think with Kidman too, who's also, isn't that they're, or all three of them really, isn't that they're particularly bad. It's that the characters are either not clearly written, or they're just they drive you nuts, or they're just there's just nothing to them.
Mm-hmm.
And I feel like she doesn't have much to work with. You know, there aren't a lot of scenes there that she could make much out of. And so, you know, everyone in it is okay. I just think the film is not put together right. And when that happens, you know, everyone's sort of adrift and, as a result, I'm not surprised that it's opening to somewhat limited fanfare, even given it's, you know, the people involved and the pedigree. I mean, the source material won an Oscar, and
yeah, there's a better film here, and it's the source material.
Yeah, I mean, like you at least that film knows what it wants to tell, whereas here they're just all over the place and. It everything gets lost. Everything gets lost in translation here. So yeah,
that's ultimately the secret of Secret in Their Eyes is that there's a better film and it's the original. So if you're looking and you're saying maybe I should go see Secret in Their Eyes this weekend, the answer to that is probably just go seek out The Secret in Their Eyes, the original film that won the Oscar, and see that one, the Argentinian film. Go watch that one. That. You'll probably get something a little bit better from it. So overall, three films this weekend. Once again, to recap, The Hunger Games: Mockingjay Part 2. I'm a little bit higher on it than Nick is. If you're a fan of the series, I think it's right up your alley. But if you're a casual fan, I think there's a little bit left to be desired there, although it does play with some interesting ideas dealing with kind of geopolitics and regime change. So that's kind of where it floated my boat. The Night Before, the Christmas comedy starring Seth Rogen, Joseph Gordon-Levitt, and Anthony Mackie made both of us laugh a great deal. And if that is your kind of prerequisite for what makes comedy for you, then I think you're going to be in luck. I think that has widespread appeal as far as comedies are concerned. And The Secret in Their Eyes. No secret here, not very good on either of our fronts. So just go seek out the 2009 Oscar winner for Best Foreign Language Film, also with the same title, and you may wind up a little bit with a better result. So that's about it. That's going to do it for this show. So Nick, before we get out of here, let everybody know once again where they can find you on the interwebs.
That's right. You can find me all over the interwebs, specifically at The Village Voice, Esquire, Daily Beast, Variety, a number of other places, The Playlist, The AV Club, and just Google me because I'm all over the place. So, you know, thanks for having me on the show. It was great, and always good to have a back and forth about some new releases.
Well, I appreciate it. Also, make sure on Twitter you find him at, is it at Nshanger? It's at N Shager.
It is. It's at N Shager.
There you go. At N-S-C-H-A-G-E-R. There you go. Spell it out for you so it's easy to find. You can also find us on Twitter at JTW Podcast and on Facebook, facebook.com/justtheworstpodcast. Find me there as well on Twitter at Infamous Kid and on Facebook, facebook.com/BillyTheKid. And all the podcasts here for Just the Worst Podcast, as well as Just the Worst Movie Review Podcast, you can find on SoundCloud. And the URL will be going up soon enough, so all those RSS, iTunes, and Stitcher feeds will be available for your convenience. Just a little bit more patience as we head through the holidays, and we'll be able to get them to you. So, as usual, I'm your host, Billy Donnelly, who you can find at thisisinfamousjoeblow.com and right here at Just the Worst Podcast. I want to thank Nick for joining us. And look, there's plenty of films out there to go check out. Find yourself a good one. And we'll be back next week with another critic and another episode as we head into Thanksgiving. So in the meantime, this has been Just the Worst Movie Review Podcast, episode number 8. Thank you very much for joining us. We're out. We'll see you later. Just the Worst Movie Review Podcast, episode number 8, has been a presentation of Just the Worst Podcast.